Shalom. First and foremost, I want to give all praises to the Heavenly Father, Yahweh, Bahasham, Yahweh Shai, Bahasham, Rachahakurash. Double honors to the apostles, the bishops, and the elders at Great Millstone, Ruel. Peace and salutations, as always, to the elect. And I wanted to do a response to this video done by the beloved brother Ash, all right, from the GMS Tampa Bay camp. As you can see here, GMS Tampa Bay 12, subscribe and be edified. All right, now what he's going into in his video is an article we were discussing, right, where you have this demon, all right, Elon Musk, which he's, presented to the people as this, you know, rebellion against the deep state, this rebellion against the NWO, this rebellion against, you know, the the elite, you know, which he himself, he's a part of it, you know. And he's low on the totem pole, but he's a face that is used, all right, and he's a part of the beast system. You know, he's forwarding what John the Revelator saw in Revelation, the 13th chapter, the RFID, all right, or what he called the MOTB, you see. And Elon Musk is one of many Edomites, all right, as well as other heathen, all right, who are in cahoots, accomplishing a diligent search to figure out a way to hijack the Heavenly Father's creation and ultimately rule on the planet Earth eternally, all right, through left-hand means. And when we say left-hand means, through the spirit of Satan, you know, through carnal means, which are associated with witchcraft, left-hand practices, technology, and his form of science, which he's taken things that are, all right, that ultimately were created for good and using them for evil. Silicon as an example, all right, which is a creation of the Most High, all right, but, you know, without silicon, there is no, you know, microchip. Without silicon, there is no, you know, computer, cell phone. You know, he basically has taken creation itself and weaponized it against humanity. But he's been able to, through his blessing, you know, put himself, you know, above and beyond of the nations. Now, anyway, getting to this video, you know, Elon Musk, which I'll get to this article. And, you know, I was watching this video, so make sure you watch it. As you can see, brain chips, MOTB. And here's the article where you see this devil Elon Musk saying his brain chip patients will soon outperform a pro gamer. Okay. Then takes a big old puff. I don't know if he took a puff of weed, crack, you know, whatever the hell, you know, these Edomites are doing. And it says, let's give people superpowers. Now, this speaks to something that I mentioned at camp, which I planned on doing a video on it tomorrow, but the spirit's on me now. So I'm just going to speak on it. How when you deal with the concept of having spiritual powers, all right, and eternal life, you know, immortal bodies, immortality, you know, a body in which you never die. Okay, the main, all right, two groups of people on the planet Earth that are pushing towards this thing, of course you have the other heathen under Esau, right? But you have Esau and you have Jacob. The elites of Jacob and Esau, all right, are the main ones openly declaring, all right, you know, the concept of having spiritual power, which they call superpowers or immortality, eternal life. Now, the elites Esau, all right? Elon Musk is a part of that class, but at the end of the day, you know, there are people who are way higher than him, in which, as the scriptures say, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against the rulers of the darkness of this world. You read that in the Geneva Bible, it says against the governments of this world. Okay, the rulers of this world, which pretty much commune directly with, you know, left-hand spirits, all right, and do the bidding of Satan in the planet Earth. And this whole MOTB system is a working of Satan that will be presented, you know, as a form of peace, safety, you know, fun, okay, and progression. As you can see here, this individual is a part of a system in which people will, you know, take brain CHIPs as a form of healing. Okay, so as you can see, this technology, not only is it just, you know, technology, but it's being presented to you as a form of helping you, as a form of helping the world from, you know, one of its many, you know, mishaps. But again, as I said at camp, when you look at the main two people or groups of people talking about, you know, spiritual powers, immortality, okay, you have the elites of Esau, as we're looking at, you know, a part of that right here with this guy. And then you have the elites of Jacob, which who are the elites of Jacob? Okay, the men of the Lord, the servants, the prophets, okay, as a part of our gospel. Okay, we were told, let's see here, greater works, let's get that real quick. All right, this is the book of John 14 and 12, which Yahushua, when he was on the earth, he came in the flesh through the loins and lineage of David, through his father Joseph and his mother Mary, fulfilled prophecy. That was the top spirit on the right hand side. He came on the earth and, you know, was dwelt amongst men. The word became flesh. And the Lord endowed him with certain powers. All right. And it takes faith to believe it. Okay. But our forefathers recorded seeing him doing certain healings, you know, walking on water. Okay, and here it is. You know, the crazy part about it is you have a lizard or a duck or a spider even that can walk on water. But to believe the Son of the Most High walked on water, you know, it takes, you know, a big leap of, you know, this it comes with a big leap of, you know, big doubt. You know, anyway, Yahushua, you know, with all of the works that he done, John 14 and 11 says, believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake. Now, NLT, it says, just believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, but they're the same power. It says, or at least believe because of the work ye have seen me do. And the works, you know, feeding thousands with, you know, pieces of fish. I mean, he did a lot more than what was written and contained in the Bible. It tells you he did so many works that, you know, a book couldn't contain them. You see? And we believe, all right, as a part of the gospel, we believe these things through faith. And, you know, here it is. You know, you have this devil boasting and ultimately forwarding humanity through his technology, through his science, okay, but and people are all for it, you know, but to believe that these things can be done in righteousness, in an even greater sense, you know, people doubt it. But as you see here, he says here, I'll read it in the NLT, it says, I tell you the truth, John 14 and 12, anyone who believes in me will do the same works that I have done, and even greater works, because I am going to be with the Father. Now, him going to be with the Father means that he returns to the right-hand side and he can send down the Holy Spirit so that we can fulfill what's needed to be fulfilled, you know, through our straight gate period and fulfill prophecy to get beamed up And when we're beamed up, pursuant to John, 1 John, the third chapter, in the first verse, it says, "Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed unto us, that we should be called the sons of the Most High." Okay? And the first, or should I say, the true birth of being a son of the Most High goes back to being ultimately chosen from the foundation of the earth and created as one of those special elect spirits under Yahweh Shai for a very, you know, important purpose for our nation. Okay? So, behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed on us, the true gift that we have, if we're of that number, is being chosen from the foundation of the earth to be a part of that, you know, ride or die body who helped Yahweh Shai create the heaven and the earth. You know, that's what ultimately, if you really understand what's happening here and what's being restored, you know, that body, those first fruit spirits, which are the Halahayim, right? Now, Yahweh Shai did what he needed to do to get back to his original estate. Now it's our turn. And once we get back, all right, the purpose is then coming to the earth, on earth as it is in heaven, and establishing order on the planet earth in heavenly bodies, in immortal bodies, right? So 1 John 3:1 says, "Beloved," or "behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed on us, that we should be called the sons of the Most High. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not." All right, see, when we deal with the world and creation, we look at it from a very, very different aspect than anyone else. So the world doesn't really understand our cause, our thought process, our faith. It's not tied to anything that they have going on. See, "Beloved, now are we the sons of God," and this process brings us back, all right, on that journey and that path back to where we need to be. "Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is." So we're going to be in though that very body Yahweh Shai is in, the body Melchizedek was in when he was on earth, where he didn't have a, you know, a father or a mother in the physical birth sense. He was the direct son of the Most High on earth. We're going to be in those bodies. And as the scriptures say in Zechariah, the 12th chapter, in the 8th verse, right? It says, "In that day shall the Lord defend the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and he that is feeble among them shall be as David." Okay? Going to be beloved. Okay? "And the house of David shall be as the Alahayim, as the angel of the Lord before them." And that angel of the Lord before them is Yahweh Shai. So the house of David, which is the 144,000, which all of our people are going to be in heavenly bodies, born into the new covenant, but the house of David are going to be a special, okay, breed. See, all of our people are going to have spiritual capabilities to some degree, but as far as the authority, okay, the house of David are going to be what? Allah, as the Alahayim. That's what that word for God is. The house of David should be as God. Well, the house of David should be as the Alahayim. And that word in the Hebrew, Alahayim, where you get the word Elohim or Allah. Allah is a Hebrew word that means power. Alahayim makes it plural. So the house of David are going to be as the Alahayim. Rulers, divine ones, angels, gods, okay? Works or special possessions of the Most High, the true power, okay? And that takes us back to in the beginning, the Alahayim created the heaven and the earth. So we're going to have those heavenly bodies, right? And as it says in the prayer in the book of Matthew, the 6th chapter, hold on, where words to say. As it is in heaven, Matthew 6, I believe. So what we're declaring is, look, Matthew, the 6th chapter and the 10th verse, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. May your kingdom come soon. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So again, when we say New Jerusalem is going to be coming down from heaven, we're basically a part of this gospel is that in the kingdom of heaven, we're going to have immortal bodies. Okay. See, okay. Let's see. 1 Corinthians 15 and 53. This corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So the elite on the right-hand side are declaring that we're going to have immortal bodies, right? That we're going to have spiritual capabilities, right? But we are going through the proper channels to achieve those things. We are offering up the proper sacrifice associated with getting those things. Verse 54, 1 Corinthians, okay? Then, in the NLT, then our dying bodies, this flesh, will be transformed into bodies that will never die. This scripture will be fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. Now, as you can see here, I just typed in immortality. And on the left-hand side, author David Martorano discussed the perils of AI in his novel Immortality. So when you deal with this AI, no one is ready for digital immortality. See, they are trying to achieve immortality by left-hand means, by carnal means. They want to upgrade humanity and humans by technology, by science, all right, falsely so-called. And many people are, you know, really, really impressed by these miracles, all right? And, you know, honestly, there is power associated with the left-hand side, right? It is like, okay, I see you, all right? But at the end of the day, to get it through right-hand means, through the right means, is far greater. And it means more, and it's not limited. See, Esau's power is very limited. But as you can see here, if Ray Kurzweil, probably a small head, is right, you will meet his immortal soul in the cloud. Now, this devil, Noah Yuval Harari, talks about the clouds, you know, in the data they store, being the gods that govern the world to come. As you can see here, transhumanist, okay? Transhumanist. Now, what is transhumanism? All right, we'll look that up. Author predicts artificial superintelligence, immortality, and singularity. So this is what these devils are talking about, okay? This is what these devils are trying to use, this technology that they're bringing about to so-called establish, and they're promising it to you, but really it's for them. As a matter of fact, check this video out.
Ultra-rich in the U.S. are the ultra-rich in the U.S. are freezing themselves so that they can wake up 100 or 1,000 years later into the future. A leading cryonics facility in the U.S. called the Alcor Life Extension Foundation is offering this futuristic service. Cryonics is the process of freezing life cells, tissues, and biological materials at below freezing temperatures to preserve them. So the Alcor Life Extension Foundation is keeping people frozen in ice-cold temperatures so that future technologies can bring them back to life. Alcor has already preserved around 230 people. Globally, approximately 500 people have undergone cryonics procedure. There is only one problem here. The process of revival is uncertain. Neurocryopreservation, the process of freezing only the brain, is priced at $80,000. Turns out the dream to stay young and rich is only afforded to the affluent.
Only afforded to the rich. So you here it is. They're gonna trick you by video games, by technology, by entertainment, by their so-called miracles. They're going to trick you into believing that they have this plan for you, which really for you, this means that you entering into this system and merging yourself with, AI or technology. It's a digital enslavement. Okay? And as you can see, even on YouTube, which is a platform that's, doesn't allow too much truth to come out, but
We are a technological society. We are technology creating species.
Right.
And we're going to keep going.
Just keep it going. And then you think the first person who might live forever with their conscious uploaded into an AI is alive right now.
I don't know if that happens. I don't know. I
it's
mean, if
possible.
That actually happens, I think something happens. I think for me to speculate would be kind of crazy, but I think something wild is going to happen pretty soon. I think with AI and the way AI is progressing, that it's going to be smarter than every human being alive inside of 5 years.
Imagine a world where death is not the end. Meet Ava, a brilliant scientist who discovers a way to upload human consciousness into a digital realm. She calls it the Haven. In the Haven, memories, thoughts, and even personalities live on forever. People can interact with loved ones, explore endless virtual worlds, and experience new adventures, all without a physical body. But there's a twist. Ava finds herself questioning the ethics of her creation. Is living forever in a digital world truly living? Can digital souls experience real emotions, or are they just shadows of their former selves? As Ava delves deeper, she realizes that true immortality might come at a cost. The line between reality and the digital world blurs, and the quest for eternal life raises profound questions.
And here it is. This devil is talking about immortal or eternal life, but he doesn't know how to live. Look at the culture. All right, what are you going to do forever? Cigarettes, like what, disease. Confused, like he doesn't know how to live, but he's talking about living forever. But as you can see, this system and everything that they're, for the elites, for them, this, what they're talking about is living forever. Okay? This is a real, okay, this is a real thing. And the scriptures tell us, right? 2 Thessalonians, the second chapter, in the 8th verse, it says, "Then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with his mouth, with the spirit of his mouth, the prophets, and destroy with the brightness of his coming, Yahweh Shai, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders." So when you look at this power, okay, here it is. You have power on the left hand, you have power on the right hand. You have power on the right hand, you have power on the left hand. We're exuding the power through the Holy Spirit, being raised from the dead, which that's a form of spiritual power. What we're doing and what's happening amongst the Israelites, we're literally fulfilling something that was written before we were even born and doing it to a T. As well as these prophecies coming to pass, we're witnessing spiritual power. But for us, see, we go from glory to glory to glory. And Esau is trying to do that very same thing. He has his left-hand prophets. They put things in books, movies, commercials, cartoons. Okay, but he's trying to, through lying wonders, through pseudoscience, through pseudo-truth, all right, a lie, conscious and intentional falsehood in a broad sense, whatever is not what it seems to be, all right, perverse, impious, deceitful precepts, all right, but he's coming to do the bidding of Satan, which when you look up the word Satan, all right, Satanas or Satanas, okay, adversary, okay, in opposition of. Okay, and that's what Esau represents. He's the pole, he's the opposite of Jacob. Okay, and when you deal with, the priesthood, all right, of Yahweh Bashim Al Shai, which is being set up through the Holy Spirit, you know, the men of the Lord, you know, Esau has a priesthood as well. All right. Even when you go, you know, the Satan means adversary. So he's trying to set up a righteous eternal kingdom, you know, for himself, where he governs the earth as the gods of the earth. Right. And the elite are serious about this because they understand that they're Edomites and we're Israelite. They understand what we possess, and they so badly want that birthright back, because with that birthright comes the real ability to do it. So because they can't have that power, they can't tap into it. All right. Their sacrifice has been rejected like Cain. They're going, all right, by other means to accomplish these things in hopes of undermining the blessing that was given unto Jacob. All right, as you can see here, these people, all right, who are at the forefront of this agenda dealing with sea change, all right, I don't want to say it here, but you know, the whole agenda, which this agenda of these people here, all right, at this forum, okay, this whole agenda is rooted in what is known as the Club of Rome. All right, Club of Rome is where they get their roots. This is where this whole agenda is rooted in. You can look that up. All right, which that's what the gates of hell, you know, Gil Bates and all of these devils. This is the agenda they're forwarding, goes back to the Club of Rome. All right, but this guy says, you know, they're declaring we are gods, and if you stand in our way, you will die. Okay, so let me see if I can pull this video up. I believe this is it. Give me one second here. Is this it?
A World Economic Forum insider has declared that the globalist elite are going to become gods, and if you interfere with this process, there will be big trouble. According to the globalists, the only way to stop them becoming gods is to kill them, and before you manage to do that, they will kill you. This is the most direct and bloodthirsty warning from the WEF to date, and it leaves no room for the mainstream media and their fact-checkers to dissemble the facts and muddy the waters. There is no room for debate. The globalist elite have messiah complexes, and they are hell-bent on playing God. Before we dive in, subscribe to the link to this WEF insider. If you don't like the agenda of the globalist elite, you don't have to participate. You can go and get yourself euthanized. If you pay close attention, you'll hear that he clearly states that they are going to become gods, and there is nothing you can do about it. If you try and resist, they will kill you.
We are going to become gods. Period. If you don't like it, get off. You don't have to contribute. You don't have to participate. But if you're going to interfere with me becoming God, you're going to have big trouble. And we'll have warfare. The only way you can prevent me in this 50 year is to kill me. If you kill me, I'll kill you.
The chilling speech mirrors warnings delivered by Yuval Noah Harari, Klaus Schwab's right-hand man in recent times. Harari also mocks ordinary people as useless and hopeless, and tells humanity they have no future worth living in the brave new world of the WEF's Agenda 2030, where the elites have the power of creation and destruction.
Developing even bigger powers than ever before, we are really acquiring divine powers of creation and destruction. We are really upgrading humans into gods. We are acquiring, for instance, the power to re-engineer life.
But the blasphemy of the elite doesn't stop there. After this quick break, we will expose their plans to supplant Jesus and Christianity in the Western world.
Yeah, so you can look that article up. I actually did a video going into this before, but when you deal with what we're promised through Yahweh Shai, in Revelation, the second chapter and the 26th verse, it says 25, but that which ye have, hold fast till I come, the truth, hold tight to it. And he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations, and he shall rule over them with a rod of iron, as the vessels of a potter shall they be broken in shivers, even as I received of my Father. See, they want this, but they're trying to do it on the left-hand side. See, they want to rule as gods on the earth, all right? Because the true gods, all right, of the earth are the Israelites, the princes of the power, see? And even in the book of Psalms, that Psalms 82, right? Because we're in this low estate. Psalms 82. And I'll start at 5. It says, they know not, all right? Neither will they understand. They walk on in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are out of course. Why? Because the true gods of the earth ain't ruling it. See? So everything is out of the order. See, this is what the kingdom of heaven, where we're preaching and where we're crying for, offers, is the order in which the creator of it wants it to be in will be established, all right? But because he's not a false balance, he's allowed, all right, heathen to rule it. He's allowed heathen to rule the earth. He's allowed us to see a process, all right, actually flourish in the earth that is rooted in rebellion against him. He's allowed the left hand, he's allowed the heathen to have their way. He's gave them their blessing, right? And it's led to the earth being, you know, out of course. It says, I have said unto you, ye are gods, all of you are the children of the Most High, but ye shall die like men, all right? And ye shall fall like one of the princes. In the NLT, verse 6, I say ye are gods, ye are all children of the Most High, the Israelites. But ye will die like mere mortals, all right? And fall like every other ruler. So the Lord put us under a curse. Now this word mortal, okay, means a human being subject to death. See? But we have in our gospel, all right, which you have the Sakari, all right, and, you know, the Genesis Israelites, they teach that ultimately we're not going to live forever. We're not going to have eternal life, because that would lead to the earth being overpopulated. So after 1,000 years, we'll go back to the spirit world. This is what these weirdos are telling you, man. And y'all sitting up there, you know, acting like these are the guys. Well, y'all going to follow those niggas right off of a cliff. Okay. And in that cliff, there's going to be a Russian troop, all right, to beat your ass over the head with a billy club. All right, he's gonna beat your ass for telling him he's gonna rule after we get returned to the land. So I have said ye are gods, but ye shall die like men. So we're mere mortals in this state, but what we're you know, proclaiming is that ultimately we are gonna rule in immortal bodies. See, when the scriptures say, right, Revelation, the 21st chapter, and I, John, in the second verse, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband, which is the church, okay? Prepared as a bride adorned for her husband, proving to you that this is the church, start with the men of the Lord, okay? It says, and I heard a voice out of heaven saying, the tabernacle of God is with men, okay, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. So he's going to dwell with us, as in times past he dwelled amongst us in a tabernacle at the time of Moses, at the temple at the time of David and Solomon. Really, Solomon. David passed away. But the, you know, now, you know, he's dwelling in us, and in the kingdom he's going to fully dwell in us by giving us that new covenant. So, New Jerusalem coming, like we're going to come out of heaven in those heavenly bodies, and we're going to have spiritual capability. The scriptures talks about how we're going to have the ability to bring a plague on the heathen, right? Zechariah 14, right? in 17, in the kingdom of heaven, all right, verse 17, NLT, any nation in the world that refuses to come to Jerusalem to worship the King, the Lord of heaven's armies, will have no reign. See? Yahweh, Bahashim Yahushua, they ain't gonna have no reign. And if the people of Egypt refuse to attend the festival, our holy days, they're gonna have to send, you know, elites of their representatives of their nation are gonna have to report to our holy days with their gifts. And if the people of Egypt refuse to attend the festival, okay, the Lord will punish them with the same plague that he sends on other nations who refuse, all right, to go. So we're going to have the ability, like Esau has harp, right? Which you could look this up. I'm not going to go too deep into it, but he has the ability to control seasons, to control weather, to control clouds. He does a lot. Okay, he even has a patent on particular storms, particular, you know, this man is crazy, man. He has a patent on particular things dealing with nature because, you know, he has on the left-hand side, he has power to do these miracles, all right? And that's what is talked about by John the Revelator in Revelation, the 13th chapter. Okay, Revelation 13 and 14. And he deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast. So he has power within his beast system to bring about all of these creations and his technology and his AI and his fourth industrial revolution. Okay. But meanwhile, he's really secretly reestablishing Rome. But he's trying to bring that domination in a sense where you will never come from up under his rulership because of the digital hub and the charagma he plans to make his own form of human beings. See, that's what he's trying to do. He's tricking you into believing, oh, this is for eternal life. This is for, you know, we're going to heal you. You know, you're going to, you know. But really, and again, this is not medical information. You know, we're literally, okay, just in the news, right? Right? We're in the news. We're just reading what's going on, and we have an opinion. So the word miracle in this scripture, Revelation 13, is, all right, Semion, all right, Semion.
Strong's G, 4592, Semion, Semion.
A sign, that by which a person is distinguished or marked, a sign, a prodigy, a portent. An unusual occurrence, and we're seeing unusual occurrences, all right, through Esau Edom, okay, right before our eyes, all right, unusual occurrence transcending the common course of nature, transcending, all right, transcend, to go beyond the range, all right, or limits of something, okay, and transcending, let's just type in transcending nature. All right, transcending nature. See what comes up. Transcending human human bodies. Oh, pig's brain transcendent surgery into his own life. Oh, Lord. Well, let's just type in transhume. Okay. This, you know. Oh, I was looking at, I wasn't clicking all. Maybe that's why I wasn't coming up with. Okay. The body, they believe, transhumanists believe that the technology to enhance human cognition and bodily function surpassing current biological limitations, which is ultimately their form of spiritual power. Okay. And this is what we're seeing these devils, all right, ultimately boast themselves in. And I thought it was interesting that the only two groups of people really tapping into this and talking about this, although you have their heathen with their philosophies, is Esau and Jacob. All right, just like in Egypt, right? The priesthood on the left-hand side, let's just type, is it magic? Let's see here. All right, these magicians here in ancient Egypt, all right, Exodus 7 and 11, and Pharaoh called the wise men and the sorcerers, and now the Egyptians of Egypt, and they did in like manner with their enchantments, which we're seeing enchantments now. All right. So they had those magicians, you know, in ancient Egypt. They had those magicians in the all of these different heathenistic empires, and that priesthood has returned. This is a priesthood, the word magician, okay, which this taps into the philosophy and the power of the serpent. Harasad, all right? It says, diviner, magician, astrologer, engraver, writer, all right, only in derivative sense, all right, of the occult knowledge. Now, what is this? This is interesting. The supernatural, the mystic, magical beliefs. So when you really deal with the ones practicing true Egyptologists, it's not Sonnetter, it's not Polite, though he may have tapped into something, but it's not Shaka Amos, all right? It's not the rest of these weirdos who are talking about Hotep, okay, trying to tell you they know somebody who can fix your credit. And then some big ass nigga woman comes on the screen, all right, telling you, you know, this and this and that, and then her credit ain't even right. Those ain't the true practices of Egyptology. The true ones who are really tapped into that energy are the elites, which it wasn't just Egypt. It goes all the way back to Sumer, which is ancient Babylon. Okay, and it goes back to the garden. All right, in which basically you are of the opinion that you can obtain immortality by your own means and undermine the Heavenly Father's order, all right, and undermine that it's only one people he chose, all right, to fulfill this, okay? He hath respect unto his saints. So when you deal with what this devil is talking about here, talking about his brain C-hip, patients will soon outperform pro gamers, meaning a pro gamer naturally becomes a gamer. He naturally learns a game. He naturally beats the game. He naturally becomes a master to the point where he's able to make money from being a gamer. Well, he's saying, well, I'm going to, by my brain C-hip, okay, outdo nature, outdo the natural way of doing things. And he also says, let's give people superpowers. Okay? So, the human brain C-hip is the pinnacle of evolution. See, and when you deal with evolution, you have what you call showcase evolution, where they show you the monkey, the man going to a monkey, which, you know, they have that science. But the true form of evolution that these devils are tapping into is evolving into gods. And see, there's only two people who really, you know, two groups of people who are really tapped into that faith, All right. It's the elites of Esau and the elites of Jacob. Okay. So I just wanted to bring that out. I mean, I'm pretty sure. Let's see what this is talking about. Elon, you know, the Neuralink, the future of humanity. This was uploaded 4 days ago.
Arbaugh, about
you might want to tap into that. But hell no, nah. 8 hours? God damn. This is the type of time these devils got. Sit around for, you know. Anyway, I don't think there's anything else I wanted to bring up, man. But the possessor of occult knowledge. Wow. You know, it says secret society to study alchemy and the occult involving or related to the supernatural, mystical. And, you know, when you read Wisdom of Solomon 12, it tells you that those Canaanites were tapped into that madness. See, but now we're living in a kingdom that has tapped, have been able to tap into that power, but now they have, all right, the abilities through their science, their technology above anything that these nations of ancient world could have even thought of. Okay? So ultimately, I just wanted to bring that out. All right, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, okay, but against principalities and the rulers of the darkness of this world, man. And Esau Edom, all right, he's really fighting for that immortality. He's really fighting for that birthright, you know. And his sacrifice is going to be rejected, all right? As the scriptures say, the sacrifices of the wicked, just like Cain's sacrifice was rejected, this sacrifice Esau is offering up right now, it's not in line with the sacrifice required, okay? The sacrifices of the wicked are an abomination. All right, what is a sacrifice? God damn, man. You tap into AI, you don't even have to think about the scripture. As soon as you say it, it pops up. You can think it up. All right, so, you're Google, right? Proverbs 15 and 8. The sacrifice of the wicked is an abomination to the Yahweh, but the prayer of the upright is his delight. So again, Cain's sacrifice was rejected. Esau, all right, was rejected. So Esau, Edom, all right, Proverbs 21 and 27, the sacrifice of the wicked is an abomination. How much more when he bringeth it forth with the wicked mind? And that's all this whole thing that we're seeing is a wicked sacrifice. It's a wicked mind. It's off, all right? But we are hoping, all right, and going up the right way, okay? We're not thieves and robbers, all right? The book of John, all right, because you have to go through Yahweh Shai to tap into that kind of power, all right? And your sacrifice has to be right. John 10 and 1, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold, all right? And through that door comes, man, innumerable powers, man, authority. But you got to go through it the right way. But climbeth up some other way, the same as a thief and a robber. So you have to go through the straight gate. You have to go through Yahweh Shai in order to tap into eternal life. Okay? Eternal life. Okay? Deacon Hakah, we're going to live forever. Okay, we're going to have eternal bodies, eternal life. They're talking about eternal life, all right, is a heathenistic mind state, is a heathenistic doctrine. Well, it's just that the heathen have always heard the teachings of the sons of God, and they've always created their own forms, man, of what we, all right, even reincarnation. They say you come back as a spider, a bug, a zebra, a rock. Here it is in your former life. Okay, you were on the planet Earth chasing women. Okay, you know, you owned a goddamn liquor store. And you come back in the next life, you're a rock or a zebra. Come on, man. You people need to grow the hell up. That ain't what the reincarnation of the scriptures is. You return, all right, within the nation you belong to, three or four generations down the line. That soul, all right, will receive its reward or its judgment, all right, through that process. Anyway, Revelation 21 and 4, and the Most High shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither no more crying, no more sorrow, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things have passed away. You guys are trying to bring an apartment mentality to eternal life. Okay? To innumerable planets, to innumerable, okay, capabilities under who the world ignorantly calls Jesus Christ, who created the heavens and the earth, who has the key of death, who ultimately has dominion over death. And you saying that in the kingdom of heaven, we're still going to have to experience death, or after a certain amount of time, we're going to, you know, go back to the spirit world. Y'all dudes are crazy. Anyway, I just wanted to tap into that. I just thought that was interesting. All right. Shalom.